Provides, oh Lord, Praise the Lord. the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
For the Lord God Almighty reigns. voices.
Holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are. today let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day
Jesus.
Jesus Christ is Lord.
Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that
Jesus. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus
Christ is Lord.
Come on, lift up your voice and worship.
Every knee
shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ. Come on, lift up his name, lift up his name.
Every knee shall bow,
every tongue
confess that Jesus.
Father, we thank you.
Jesus Christ.
Father, tonight we praise you and we worship you.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord right now.
Hallelujah.
Worship his name. Thank you, Jesus. As part of our time of worship, I believe giving is part of our worship tonight. So I want to invite you to give your tithes and your offering. I'm sorry there's no card machine at the back today, but if you want to give online, you can go to propheticvoice.com and you can give via PayPal and bank transfer. Father, we worship with our giving tonight. We praise you, we worship you. We love your kingdom. We want to see your power. We want to see your glory. And Father, as we give tonight, we give with expectation. We give with reverence and adoration. So as you prepare your offerings tonight and your tithes, just say to the Lord, ask the Holy Spirit, how should I give tonight? Let the Holy Spirit speak to you about your giving tonight. Father, we worship you tonight with our giving.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Are you ready? So as we give worship, you can give your tithe and your offering. Amen. Sing.
No other name, Jesus. Jesus. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus, my heart will sing. No other name, Jesus,
Jesus, isn't it?
Yes.
All about him.
Yes.
Father, we just thank you for Jesus today.
Yes.
Father, we thank you for what he did on that cross for each and every one of us, Lord. Father, we thank you that he set us free from sin and death. Father, we give you the glory tonight. We praise you, Lord. We thank you. Thank you, worship team. That's good. Father, I just thank you for the offering, Lord. I thank you for everybody who's given, Lord. Lord, that you would press down, shaking together, you'll give back to each one of us, Lord. Father, I thank you for that. Amen. Amen. That worship was good tonight, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Hello? Yes? Amen. It was good. I think it's Claudia's birthday today, isn't it?
Yes.
So we just want to wish happy birthday, Claudia. I know she's not here, but happy birthday to you, dear. Yeah. Dr. Sharon's on her way, I think, is she on her way? Flying back, yes. So you've got me tonight, so praise God. Anyway, praise God. Yes, hallelujah. It is all about Jesus. It's what Jesus has done on that cross for each one of us. And, you know, tonight I'm looking at people and I'm looking at hopefully people that are mature. And God is looking for a mature people. God is mature in his body, you know, and I hope I'm going to speak to mature people tonight. God has done things in each and every one of us, our lives, and he's called us, and he's anointed us, he's given us promises, he's given us his promise, son, he's given us his promises for our future. And each one of us, I went round each one of us, I would say eight, because this is a prophetic church, isn't it? Yeah, I would say each one of you has got prophetic words over your life. Amen? Am I talking to the right people tonight? Yeah? And these prophetic words have probably not even come true yet. They haven't been fulfilled yet. Hello? Yes? Yes. You know, and it's like God has promised us things, but we're not always seeing the fulfillment of that. And sometimes God is doing some work in each one of us. And God is doing work in us. And he's changing us. He's changing the way you think. He's changing the way you act. He's changing everything about you. Amen? Because he's making you into the image of Jesus Christ. And that is a but they don't always fulfill. They're not always. There's a process that we have to go through. There's a process that you have to go through. Turn around to your neighbor and just tell them, there's a process you're going through. You know, we sometimes think with God, it's like immediate. You know, how many of you got your prophetic words and you felt, yeah, I'm making it. God's got this for me and God's got that for me. And there's an excitement. But then you go down the road a little bit and when's it going to happen? Why isn't it happening? There's one person nodding. Maybe you're not like me. Maybe you haven't had that happen to you. And the process is God wants to change the way you are. He wants to kill some things in you. You know, he wants to mature us. You know, we're hearing a lot about shaking. You know, the world's been shaken. I mean, it really is shaking, isn't it? There's a lot of things going on. But what are you putting your trust in? What are you putting your trust in? See, God wants to shake some things out of you. He wants to take some things out of you. But you say, oh, well, the kingdom of God doesn't get shaken. No, it doesn't get shaken. But there's two parts to you and me. The Spirit of God lives in me by the Spirit, but there's a flesh part in me that wants to rule and reign. It says that do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed. And there's a transformation going on, but the Spirit of God wants you. It's the Spirit that doesn't get shaken. Everything else is going to be shaken. He's going to shake you in the flesh. He wants you to be a spirit man or woman, because it's the same thing. He wants you to be spirit people that are led by the Spirit, moved by the Spirit. So tonight, I just want to share a few things. One of the things the scripture I want to start with is Romans chapter 8, verse 28 and 29. It says, for we know that all things work together for those who love God and who are called according to his purposes. Do you love God tonight? Well, if you love God, all things are going to work out for you. Because God is working it out, even before you realize that you're even going to be a Christian. He knew from the very beginning what you're going to be like. All things work together for good for those who are loved and called to God. If you're loved and called to God, all you have to do is accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you're not accepted because you haven't stepped into the things of God, or you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then that's something you need to do. I forgot I'm online as well. I like to move around, you know. So it's about Jesus Christ, accepting Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Okay, all things work together. But the storms come, the rains come, the problems come to all our lives. Yes? There's no different. All right, I want to go to Genesis. I want to share some things out of Genesis. And you probably all know the story. It's about Joseph. Genesis 37. They asked me about a title tonight, and I said, I don't know, I haven't got a title. I'm not you. Oh, you're giving it to, have you? I'm not one that puts titles on things. I wouldn't even know how to do it, you know? Genesis 37, this is the story of Joseph. You all know the story probably, but there's just a few things I want to bring out in this story, and I want to sort of connect it to you and connect it to me, because we're all the same, all right? God gave Joseph a dream, all right? Joseph was a young lad. He was his father's favorite, and he had a coat of many colors, and he had brothers, and they persecuted him because he had a dream. From prison to the palace, yeah. From the prison to the palace, yes, amen. That wasn't my title. That was Eunice's title. So Joseph had this dream, you know, but his brothers didn't like him. They hated him. They envied him because his father loved him. You all know the story. I'm not even going to read it. I'm just going to abbreviate some things out of it. So, you know, he was hated. He was jealous of him. And, you know, sometimes we have family people in our lives. We come across people in our lives that don't always like us as well, you know. They envy us. They don't like us. Anyway, but he had a dream, He had a destiny and a call, and it's like, you've got a destiny, you've got a call, and you've got a dream. And we've got to be careful that the dream is not stolen from us. So Joseph had this dream. He was foolish enough to tell his brothers. They hated him even more. They hated him even more because he told him, right? They didn't like him at all. He told his father the dream, and he wasn't cross. Well, why are you having this dream? Well, he couldn't help it, could he? God gave him a dream. So he had it in his heart that God was going to do something for, you know, with him. Each one of you has got it in your heart that God is going to do some things, use you. But as we go on with God, as we go on in life, we've got to be careful we don't lose that dream. We've got to be careful that the enemy doesn't come and rob us of that dream. So what happens? Joseph was his brother and sisters went to feed the animals and went off with the animals, and he was told by his father to go off and check on his brothers. You know, he told tales on his brothers. He wasn't a nice young man. You know, sometimes when you come become Christians, we're not always the nicest, are we? Eh? There's got to be things dropped off us. There's got to be things taken away from us. God takes away some things. You think, oh, where did that come from? You know, anyway, there's Joseph. He goes out and he starts wondering. He's looking for his brothers and he's wandering around and he gets lost, basically. I think it's about verse 15. He gets lost and he's wandering around looking for his brothers. He was told to go by his father to look after something. And it's like us sometimes that we get this prophetic word, or we get an understanding that God has more for us than what we realize right now. He's got a purpose for us, and we start wandering around. We're looking for what God has got for us. When's it going to happen, God? What's going to happen? You've said this, God. When's it going to happen? When's it going to happen? But God is doing something in you and something in me, just as he was doing something in Joseph. Joseph was wandering around. He was wandering around in the area looking for his brothers. He met somebody. See, some of you might be wandering around right now looking, God, well, where am I going? What am I doing? What's this happening? When's this going to happen? He met somebody on time. You might think, well, that's strange. But he met this person. He told him where his brothers was. You know, we can read the story we can look and see the end from the beginning, but at the time he didn't know, but he was going to step into his destiny. He was going to step into things that he didn't realize. And it's not always nice when we read what it says here. He says he went, found his brothers, just in time. I'll tell you why it was just in time. Because it was to catch a train. It was to catch the camel train. Nobody got that, did they? The slavers. He was going to be killed. They wanted to kill him, his brothers and sisters. You know, the enemy wants to kill your dream. Circumstances want to kill your dream. Just as Joseph, you know, was hated, but he still went and did what his father told him. He still went, he wandered around looking for his brothers. And we can wander around looking for our destiny. Is it this way? Is it this? Am I connected to this person? Am I connected to that person? What am I connected to? God, you said it. We fall away sometimes. We get disappointed. We can lose. But this guy was then put in a pit. Didn't get any better for him. He was thrown in a pit and they were going to kill him. Just like the devil wants to come and he wants to rob you. You know, he wants to rob and he wants to steal. But did God know that? Yes, he did. All things work together for good for those who are called according to his purposes. All things. We don't like to hear things like that. God knew that he was going to be thrown in a pit. God knows what you're going through right this moment. Eunice is telling me what to preach. Throw me off now. No, but seriously, you know, God knows what you are going through right now and what you're struggling with. Because we are struggling, each one of us, because God wants to mature us. He doesn't want us to be a struggle. He wants us to be the spirit man and woman that he's called us to be. He wants us to reach our destiny just as much as you want to reach your destiny. So there's Joseph. So he's been thrown into the pit and he caught the train because they were going to kill him, but the train came. The slavers came. Look, let's give him to the slavers. It didn't get any better for him. How do you think he felt? How do you think he felt that his brothers turned against him? Maybe brothers and sisters have turned against you. Maybe people have said things about you. Maybe you're feeling it because you've been persecuted. Well, this guy was thrown into the pit. Maybe you've been thrown in the pit. I remember getting a prophetic word one time saying that, you know, you've been, it got no better for Joseph, and it's not going to get any better for you either. Just as Joseph was thrown in the pit, I thought, that was a nice prophetic word. Let me tell you something. Why is that happening? Because God is maturing us. Joseph did not have the character to do what God has called him to do. God hasn't, you haven't got the character right now, maybe some of you have, to fulfill what God has called you to do. And that's hard, that is. We don't like to hear that. You know, we think, I don't know if you're like me, but you get thrown in a pit or you get thrown, things go wrong. Oh, the devil's after me. Oh, the devil's done this and the devil's done that. No, it's not the devil, it's circumstances. We only give the devil an opportunity to come in if we open doors. But God is maturing us, and we go through storms, and he matures us through the storms. He matures us through life. He matures you and me through the circumstances that you go through. And we don't like to hear that. There's Joseph. Not only was he thrown in a pit, and just before he went, he was stripped of his coat. Remember he had his coat? It says they stripped his coat off. See, Joseph had an identity in the flesh. Maybe some of you have got identities in the flesh, but God wants to strip it off. He says, I'm stripping off. Stripping off. He stripped off. They stripped his coat off. That was his identity. They knew him by that. Maybe some of you, God wants to strip off some of your identities in the flesh. Because it's about the Spirit. It's about maturing in the Spirit. We are Spirit people because the winds of change are coming. The winds of change are coming, and God's blowing the winds of change. What are you sticking into? What are you struggling with? What are you trusting in? Are you trusting in God, what he said about you? Are you trusting in that Jesus is the Lord? He's Lord of all. That all things work together for those who love God. Yes, I love God. We've got to keep our eyes on God. There's a stripping off. God wants to strip off some things in our lives, and it's called the flesh. It's called, what am I putting my trust into? What is your identity? Well, it might be your job. It might be because I'm this person or I'm that person. It might be because you can prophesy, or it might be because you can have gifts. It might be because you can worship or you can do other things. What is, you know, but that's not what you're called to. That's not your identity. Your identity is Jesus Christ. That's who your identity is. Your identity, you are Christ Jesus. Christ lives in you, the hope of glory. He's changing you, he's molding you, he's shaping you. He's bringing you to a place where that you can carry what he's got for you. We don't like to hear these things. We don't like, oh, I don't want to go in a pit. I don't want to go through struggles. I don't, you know, but these things happen to us because he's maturing us to carry more. He's maturing you to take more. It's about Jesus. You know, stripped off him. What are you trusting in? Are you trusting because you can prophesy, or you can pray for people, or is that who you are? No, it's not. What are you trusting in? His identity was stripped off him. God is taking our identity off us, so it's not me, it's Christ in me. Because sometimes we think, oh, I've made it now, I can prophesy to people. Am I saying that because we're a prophetic church? But it might be because I can stand up here and sing, or I can play the keyboard, or what, and that's who I am. No, it's not who you are. That's a gift that God has given you. That's an ability, you know. God gives the gifts, but he's not interested in gifts. He gives the gifts. He's interested in what you're doing with it. He's interested in your character. He's challenging you. He's changing you. Joseph had to go through that from the pit, from stripping off his identity. I hope I'm making you think tonight. Praise God. So there's Joseph. What happens then? is sold into slavery. And then he's didn't get any better for him. He was sold to Potiphar. You know who Potiphar was, don't you? He was an official of the Pharaoh. He was the chief executioner of Pharaoh. He went into Potiphar's household. He was sold into him. Can you imagine what this 17-year-old boy was going through? Can you imagine the rejection? But he still knew that something was, he had a purpose and a destiny because God told him. But if you're going through things, sometimes we forget what God has said. We forget our prophetic words. We forget what the encouragement God gives us. We forget that sometimes he just brings somebody alongside you at the right time just to keep you on track. We forget, we want it all nice and wrapped up in a nice bow. We want the Christianity to be nice and clean, and God, I'm going to walk into being a whatever you're called to do, or whatever area you're in, because we're all called to different areas. Not everybody's called up here. You're called to different areas of the kingdom. So Joseph goes into the Potiphar's house, and it says in if you whip over to 38, is it? Genesis 39, 38. No. Anyway, what he did, chapter 39. So Joseph went down to Egypt. We know what Egypt is. Egypt's the type of the world. He came out of things he knew, and he went into the world. And he went into Potiphar's house. And in verse 2 it says, and the Lord was with Joseph. He was a slave. He was in bondage. He was going through quite a lot of problems in his own eyes. But it says the Lord was with him. I want to tell you this today, tonight, the Lord is with you. The Lord is with you for whatever you're going through. Whatever you're facing, whatever pit you've been in, whatever stripped away, whatever's been taken away from you, the Lord is with you. And it says he was a prosperous. How can you be prosperous? He was prosperous in Potiphar's house, it says. It says he was prosperous and he was successful. So he was raised up, and Potiphar saw that. And it actually says he served. Hello? He served. His attitude was changing. He served. Would you serve if you're a slave? You wouldn't probably do, you'd be probably like me. Grumbling, you know, I'm not doing that. And you have to do it, you know. I'm not doing that. And then you end up doing it. But his attitude was right. Potiphar saw his attitude. He saw that God was still in him. Let me tell you, God sees. I mean, people see what you're carrying. Hello? People see what you're carrying. People looking at you all the time. He was blessed. You're blessed. The Bible says, I will never leave you or forsake you. Well, if he says, I will never leave you or forsake you, then he's with you all the time. When you're going through the storms, when you're going through whatever you're going through, the good times, the bad times, the valleys, and the mountaintop experiences. We can't live on a mountaintop experience. We're living because God is changing us. That is the purpose he's got for us. To change, I crucify the flesh. I take up my cross and I walk. We don't like to hear that. We don't like to have those things said about us. We don't like to face them. We think, everything's going to be fine and tickety-boo. It is going to be fine and tickety-boo. It is going to be fine because the Lord is with you. God is with you. He was blessed and he became a blessing. What are you serving in when you're going through things? Are you just looking for this? I'm going to be, all right. saving. It's a big word. It's sometimes can be a dirty word in the church. I don't know. We like just to come in and just do our thing, don't we? We just like to come in and just do our little bit. But are we saving? Am I saving God? Because at the end of the day, you're not saving man, you're saving God. It says, do all things to save God. Save him. So when you're saving, you're not saving, even in your job, even in your physical work you're doing, you're not saving those people, you're saving God. And God will bless you and he'll bless them as well. Because Potiphar's house was blessed because of Joseph. Wherever you are, if you're a child of the living God, you're a blessing to wherever you are. You're a blessing in your own home, you're a blessing in your workplace, you're a blessing because God is going to bless you. But we've got to change our attitude, we've got to change what we're thinking about serving. Because, you know, it's not serving man, it's serving God. You know, am I serving God? Well, I'm serving God because I'm going to be a pastor and I'm going to be a leader, or I'm going to have a prayer meeting, I'm going to have an intercessory group. That's not serving God. That's part of it. That's part. It's not who you are. You're a child of the living God who is doing work in you to touch other people. He wants to change you so that you can be effective in every area of your life. You are not. That's not serving God. It's serving God in everything you do. Serving God, putting chairs away. Serving God, doing whatever you're doing. Every area of your life. Sometimes we don't like to hear that. We think, well, I'm all right. I'm a pastor. Or I found my niche. You know, God told me this, and I'm going to be this and this and this. Let me tell you, I thought I found my niche quite a few years ago. I used to pastor. I gave that up when I went into the mission fields. And then as I was in the mission fields, I was doing things, and I really, really, really thought that was it. I thought, this is where God's got me. I'm enjoying this. I'm comfortable with this. I'm working with churches. I'm working with leaders. I'm working with people. And I thought, this was it. And then all of a sudden you think, oh, well, you know, God takes that away. And you think, what's happening, Lord? Well, that devil's done it. No, it's not the devil. God's allowed things to happen. Circumstances happen. Circumstances happen that change things. Because God is challenging you. He went through things. He served in Potiphar's house. He did things in Potiphar's house. Potiphar was blessed because of him. And then we all know what happened. We all know what happened. He was Potiphar's wife tried to seduce him, and he was falsely accused. Didn't get any better for him. He went from there, he went to the prison. He could have gone to the but he didn't. The blessings of God were obviously upon him, because Potiphar could have gone like that with him, because he was the chief executioner. Doesn't say it in this Bible, but it says it in one of the other Bibles. You know, it's very quiet in here. Very quiet. So you know, and we go through these things, and we think, why is it happening, Lord? What's going on? You said this and it's not tallying up. You said this, Lord, and it's not working out. No, because God's dealing with you. God had a big call for him. Each one of us has got a call. Maybe not as big as Joseph's call, but you've got a call and you've got a destiny, but God is still working in you. Because, you know, you've got to be putting your trust in God. You've got to be putting your trust in Jesus Christ. It's about Jesus. It's about him and you. It's, you know, oh, we love you, Jesus. And it's about Christ in me, the hope of glory. It's changing you from one degree of glory to another. It's changing you through the image of him. It's changing the way you think. It's changing the way you act. Do not be conformed. We have to change. God doesn't change. We change. And we don't like it. We don't like this, all these things into us. But God blessed Joseph even through all these things. He went into the prison. What happened to him in the prison? He went straight into the prison. He was raised up in the prison. Why? Because what he carried, his attitude. You know, wherever you go, you're going to be blessed if your attitude's right. If your character's right, God's interested in your character. He's not interested in that you run a prayer meeting here, or you prophesy to this person, or you pray for that person. He is, but he isn't. You know what I mean? That's not it. That's not the be all and all of it. But even your calling is not interested in your character, so he can use you in the right place at the right time. He wants to use you in the right place at the right time. Joseph was in the right place, but he didn't like it. I'm sure there was tears. I'm sure there was pain. There's pain when there's rejection. There's pain when there's pain when we don't see the answers and the things coming through. But what did he do? He didn't shut himself away in a corner. He didn't feel sorry for himself. He didn't have a pity party. I mean, I don't know if you've ever been to one of those, have you? Pity parties. I used to have a lot of them. Used to be, you know, I used to often have a pity party. You know? Why is this happening to me? If you're God, why is this happening? Not realizing that God is dealing with you. I wasn't ready. I thought I was ready. Maybe you think you're ready. But God is doing things. He's making you ready if you cooperate with him. Keeping your attitude right. Trusting him. Believing on him. So what happens in the prison? He served in the prison. He served. He was put in charge of the prisoners. He served the prisoners. Not he was served, he served. He served people. What are we called to? Serve. Jesus came to serve. We're called to be like Jesus. We're called to serve. We're called to give life. We're called to set the captives free. We're called to do all those things. But it's not you, it's the Spirit of God inside you. It's listening to what the Spirit of God is saying. It's letting God work in you, being observant, taking the most of every opportunity. God wants to use you, but he also wants to deal with you. And this is basically what I'm talking about tonight. You know, we can all have gifts, we've all got gifts, we've all got things on our life and prophetic words on our life, but God is dealing with us and we don't like it. We think it's the enemy sometimes. We think it's ourselves. We think, oh, what's wrong with me? I can't make it. Yes, you can, because God is doing some things in our life. He's shaking things off. He's taking things off, just as he was with Joseph. So he went in there. So he's in the prison. What did he do? He used his gift. He was a dreamer. It says his brothers called him a dreamer and who had dreams as well. So he obviously interpreted dreams and he had dreams. And so there was more going on in Joseph than what actually was said here. But he interpreted dreams. You know, these guys had these dreams and he interpreted them. I'm not even going to go into that, but he interpreted the dreams and they came through. One was, and the other one went off and did what he was doing. He was a cupbearer, you know, just as Joseph have said. And he said to the one at the end, he says, don't forget me. Don't forget me. Don't forget me that I'm here. Don't forget I'm in here. I shouldn't be in here. He still had some things to shake off. He still wasn't, he was trusting man. Tell Pharaoh about me. You know, he'd been in there from his 17. He probably went in there 17. He was in there, how many say 13 years? He was in jail, he was in captivity for 13 years, all right? So he interpreted the dreams and he was forgotten, he went on for another 2 years. What would we have done? What would you have done? I had a pity party, you know, said. We would though, wouldn't we? Why isn't it happening? Why isn't it happening today? Why isn't it happening? Because it wasn't God's timing. God was dealing with him. There's also, as an aspect as well, that we have to put our faith in things as well. We've got to believe God. We've got to trust God. We've got to expect things to happen. He ain't going to say it that it's not going to happen, but it ain't just going to happen. So there he is. He's still forgotten. It's 2 years. Still in that jail, he's still in that place of 2 years. What did he do? He doesn't say, but I would say he served. And then we all know what Pharaoh did, don't we? Pharaoh had a dream. And he got people together. Nobody could interpret it. Then the guy that went out said, he confessed his sins, really. I should have said something about this guy. You know? And he said, quickly. Sometimes it's suddenly. You know, suddenly. We've got to be aware of suddenlies. We've got to be aware quickly. We've got to keep our attitudes right. We've got to be focused right. We've got to be speaking right. We've got to be living right. We've got to be trusting God. All those things are all part of what's going on in our life. You know, it's all the things that the Word of God says. Don't let the Word of God out of your mouth. Let it be in your heart, meditating it day and night. So this, suddenly it was basically, he was put into the courts of Pharaoh, shaved, washed, new clothes, went before Pharaoh. That was the beginning of where God wanted him to be in the first place. But he had to go through things. You have to go through. What are you putting your trust in? Who are you putting your trust in? You know, are you looking at other things? Are you trying to do it yourself in the flesh? Because it won't work in the flesh. Are you trying to push yourself forward? It won't work. It's God that does it. God is pushing. In Ephesians chapter 2, it says, God has prepared good works for you and for me to walk in. Ephesians 2:10. God has prepared those for you. All right? It says you are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. So there's a changing, there's a something going on. One of the things I believe as well is that the body of Christ has got to be joined together. One of the things I think, this guy was on his own, but you know, now God is joining us, the body of Christ. There's a joining together. We can't do things on our own anymore. We need each other. I need you, you need me. Everyone needs each other because each one brings you apart. Because it says when you're joined together, it doesn't only go and say joined together, it's knitted together. Well, if you're knitted together, we need each other to knit together to fulfill what God has called us. Because we are called to be the light. We are called to change situations. You know, what I'm saying tonight, please, there's no condemnation for those in Christ. What I'm saying is, walk by the Spirit and not the flesh. God is changing you, all right? God is doing things in your life to fulfill your destiny. Okay? And we sometimes wonder what God is doing. But he says, all things work together for good, for those who love the Lord. As I say, you're his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, you know? And let's turn to Romans chapter 8. This is, you know, I preached here a month ago or so. I haven't preached for a long, long time. And I'm just getting used to preaching. Romans chapter 8 is talking about my Bible's falling to bits. Romans chapter 8. Verse 31 says, what shall I say then about these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? If he did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who's bringing a charge against God's elect? Is it God who justifies? Who is it that condemns? Christ Jesus who died, furthermore, he is risen. You know, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation? Shall distress? Shall persecution? Shall famine? Shall nakedness? Shall peril? Or the sword? Nothing can separate you from the love of God. Whatever you're going through, whatever situation you're in right now, nothing can separate from the love of God. But it takes a mindset. It takes you to. This is why we have to renew our mind in the things of God. This is why we need to know who we are. That God is for you, even you're going through the rain, even you're going through the storms. What are you focusing on? You're focusing on Jesus Christ. That he's started a work. Nothing's going to separate you because he loves you. Because Christ is in you, the hope of glory. But Christ is in you, the hope of glory. Colossians, it talks about doing all things as serving the Lord. saving God. God has given you, I know it might be, God has given you gifts. God has called you, but you've still got to start using them. But that's not your, that is not your identity. It's not who you are, because you're representing Jesus Christ. What gifts have you got? You use them. Do all things as serving the Lord. Everything is serving God. From the lowliest to the highest. God's going to bring you to that place of promise. The promises he says, his promises are yes and amen. If he says it, it's going to happen. The only way it's not going to happen, if you don't believe it and you don't, and you lose, let something steal your dream. The enemy wants to steal your dream. Circumstances want to steal your dream. Other people want to steal your dream. But we see from here that Joseph didn't lose his dream. He served God. He loved God. He went through the circumstances. He could have gone turned around any time. How many people do you know that have been Christian and walked away because it hasn't worked out for them? That's the only way you're not going to fulfill your call and dream, if you walk away. You have a choice. You have a choice to go through the things. You have a choice not to. But you will miss out what God has got for you. It ain't just going to fall in your lap. That's what I'm trying to say. You have to believe. You have to trust. You have to serve. You have to do what God has called you to do. But it's not about the flesh. It's about the Spirit. And that's what it's all about. God is wanting us to walk in the Spirit. And if I walk in the Spirit, you are in the Spirit when Christ is in you, but we have to walk in that. We have to, I don't want to go even further than that one, but we have to walk in it. What comes out of our mouth? Am I praising God, cursing men? James talks about it, doesn't he? What's he say when you go through things? Count it pure joy when you go through trials and tribulations. Because it brings patience. Patience, let patience have its full work. We don't like to. Time to finish. It's going like that. Right, James chapter 1. My brethren, count it pure joy when you fall into various trials. For the testing of your faith produces patience. Let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect, complete, lacking nothing. That's what we want to be, doesn't it? Hello? That's what we want to be, perfect. That we have to go through things. He had to go through things. You have to go through things. Trust God, because he's, all things work together for those who love God and called according to his purpose. I hope it's encouraging you tonight that even what you're going through, that God is with you. He will never leave you. How can he leave you? How can he leave you? He lives in you. We don't go on our feelings. He lives in you. He says, I'll be with you forever. I've given you a guarantee, a deposit. The Spirit of God lives in you because you are, you've been stamped. You've got the guarantee inside you when the Spirit of God lives in you. When you ask Jesus Christ to come into your life. When you say those words, God, come in. We don't realize what we're saying sometimes. But it's only as you go on with God, you see what he's doing in our lives, what his purpose in our life is, what his destiny has got for you. And it's good. It's very good. But we still have to go through it. I used to quote that, count it pure joy. God showed me a long time ago, you know, count it pure joy when you go through things. We will go through things. You will go through things. We go through storms. But ultimately, it's our trust is in Jesus Christ. Our trust is in God. He's going to fulfill the call. He's got works for us to do. And we will go through. We will reach our destiny if we keep it. We don't fail. In fact, he talks about it, doesn't he? He says, be like a soldier. What does a soldier do? He fights. And he says, be like an athlete. What does they do? They're disciplined. They're trained. They're disciplined. And he says, be like a farmer. He plants and he sows. You know, all those things we're called to be. And he give you more revelation on it, talks about it. But it's we don't like sometimes, we like it easy, we want it just to be like that. Oh, I want a prophetic word. And you get one prophetic word here, and you get another prophetic word there. And a lot of people are just looking for prophetic words. They're not doing the things what God has called them to do in the first place. You know? God encourages us along the way. God, you know, it's like that. He was wandering. He was wandering in the desert looking for his brothers and sisters. And a man came, the right time. Because if it had been another day, he would have missed the train. He would have gone on that camel train, he wouldn't have gone to prison or to Potiphar's house. But God is perfect. The timing of God is perfect. You will not miss God. Let's just stand right now. Father, I just thank you. I thank you, Lord, that we will not miss you, Lord. That you're working in our lives. You're changing us. You're working out your purposes and your destiny. And Father, I thank you for that right now. I thank you, Lord, right now that I just release your purpose and destiny in each one of these people tonight, Lord. Father, that as we reach out, just reach out tonight and say, yes, Lord, I want to reach my destiny in you. Just tell him tonight that you want to reach your destiny. Father, we thank you, Lord, tonight. Lord, I want to reach my destiny in you, Lord. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you're working in my life. I give you permission to work more and more in my life. Let it come over fast. Let it be done faster. Lord, I don't want to go through 13, 14 years of imprisonment and being bondage and in the wilderness again. Lord, I want to fulfill. Lord, make it quick, Lord. Lord, I yield to you. Tell him tonight that you yield to him. Tell him that you want him. Tell him that it's all about him. Father, we thank you, Lord, tonight. Father, I just thank you right now. Father, I thank you for your peace. I thank you for your love. I thank you for your mercy upon each one. In the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 For those who are online, thank you for joining us. Sorry I didn't really preach to you, but I am preaching to you. I'm preaching to us all. I'm preaching to myself. Because I want... Sorry? Especially to myself. There's no point standing up preaching to other people if you're not preaching to yourself. Because it's about that, isn't it? Just turn to somebody and just bless somebody before you go. Just encourage somebody this evening. Amen.